The Lady of Shalott is a lyrical ballad that plausibly served as Tennyson's first outpouring of his fascination for medieval culture and folklore. Tennyson claimed it was inspired by Donna di Salotto, a 13th century Italian romance, which in itself is inspired by the Arthurian legend of Elaine of Astolat, a lady in a castle who dies of unrequited love. Arthurian legend is used to refer to the body of stories in medieval romances centered around King Arthur, known also as the Matter of Britain, but that's for another time. The Lady of Shalott was written for the first time as a poem of 20 stanzas when he was all of 22 and revised subsequently through the removal of one stanza, and this second version will form the subject matter of this video. The revision was a direct result of the harsh criticism that came his way, specifically from John Stuart Mill for the London Review, who called the ending a lame and impotent conclusion, and a rather caustic review from John Wilson Croker. Nonetheless, The Lady of Shalott eventually won out lasting acclaim and remains a preeminent part of Tennyson's creative body of work. The poem is divided into four numbered parts with discrete isometric stanzas, or stanzas of equal length. While parts 1 and 2 have 4 stanzas each, part 3 has 5 and part 4 has 6. Each stanza is of 9 lines with a rhyme scheme of AAA, BCC, CB. The first 4 lines are rhymed, as also are the 5th and the 9th and the 6th, 7th and 8th. The meter varies both between tetrameter and trimeter and iambic and trochaic. Of course, in addition to these structural intricacies, it's important to remember that this is a ballad, which is defined by the Poetry Foundation as a popular narrative song passed on orally. And I do think that tradition aspect ties in rather neatly with the theme of medieval literature. The first part of the poem is a vivid description of the setting. On either side of a river, there are fields of barley and rye, and down the field runs a road to Camelot, King Arthur's court and castle. There are people walking down the road and their eyes wander to the lilies that bloom around the titular island of Shalott. There are aspens and willows and the wind gently moves the water in the river that eventually leads us to a tower of grey walls that imprisons the Lady of Shalott. There are boats in the river and horses by the river, which is to say there is some semblance of human activity, but no one has seen or even heard of the lady. Only the reapers at work in the barley fields can hear a song carried by the winds, and at night, when all the world is asleep, they whisper to themselves that it's the fairy, the Lady of Shalott. In the opening lines of part 2, we learn that the Lady of Shalott is a weaver. She weaves by night and day, caring little for the world with bright colours, possibly tapestries, partly because she's been told that an unknown curse would befall her should she cast her gaze down to the castle of Camelot. The mirror in the room that she weaves in, and that mirror reflects the world outside for her delight, her only delight of the day. The highways, the rivers, the peasants and the market girls, the women, the shepherds, the abbot and the page. She also sees a knight sometimes, and that reminds her of how she has no knight to call her own, our first glimpse into her isolation. And yet, she delights in viewing the sights in the mirror. But that delight is not without its sorrows. That she can only see the world through reflections or shadows gets to her, especially when she sees a funeral heading down to Camelot or a pair of newlyweds walk by her tower at night. In the third stanza, we're introduced to our heartbreaker, Sir Lancelot, who featured regularly in the Arthurian legends as a heroic knight. A stone's throw or a bow shot away from her tower, he rides on his horse, with the sunlight turning his armor golden. His bridle glittered like stars in the galaxy, and his bridle bells rang merrily in the air as he rode down to Camelot. The saddle shines against the blue sky, and his helmet and the feather in it burned like a flame. And if that wasn't enough, he resembled a meteor in the purple skies. And eventually, his glowing temple and his lovely black hair make their way to the lady's mirror. He pauses by the river and chants Tirulira, a sound commonly associated with larks and robins. The image and the chant together are enough for the lady to look away from the loom, take 3 paces through the room and look down to Camelot. And the minute she does that, the curse comes calling. Her tapestry is caved through the casement, her mirror cracks and she exclaims in alarm, "The curse has come upon me." Things are coming to a head in the final part of the poem. As a storm comes calling and the pale yellow woods change colour, she left her tower, found a boat, left her name inscribed on its prow, and lay down on it. She looked down the river with an expression that resembled that of a clairvoyant foreseeing his own misfortune, until she loosened the chain and sailed away onwards to Camelot at dusk. She was in a white robe that fluttered in the air as she sang her last song, her mournful carol still singing in the air, her eyes darkened and her blood froze right by the Camelot towers. She lay there, somehow pale and gleaming, as the people, the lords and the dames, the knights and the wealthy, and most importantly, Sir Lancelot, the man that led her away from her loom, paused remark on how lovely she looked and prayed for her mercy. There is an interpretation of the poem as a conflict, an intermingling between art and life. How does an artist strike a balance between their instinctive desire for social involvement and the commitment to art, and how intrinsic is creating to living life? Her tapestry flew away the moment she left her room. The end of her artistic isolation marked the death of her creativity, and eventually that gave way to her death as well. And yet, that is not all that the poem is remembered for. The employment of metaphorical visual imagery in specific merits discussion. The descriptions of the funerals and the weddings that she sees in the mirror are a warped reflection of her own life. To love and to be loved, or to be married, or a funeral procession, the Lady of Shalott was never fortunate enough to have these. As for Sir Lancelot himself, the Red Cross Knight was a symbol of courage and chivalry in medieval literature, and the descriptions of his appearance between the shining armor and the burning helmets are essential to establish the desperation that the lady experienced. The sadness of that desperation is accentuated by Sir Lancelot sparing nothing more than a cursory courtesy when she dies. We transition through the different stanzas in different ways, a change of tense from the present to the past, sunlight giving way to rainfall, and vibrant scenes transforming to pale shadows. At the end of the day, the charm of the poem doesn't rest in any one aspect. It draws from the depth, the images, the rhythm, the mystery, the sadness.